beloved. I am Zadkiel of the Divine Presence, and I come bearing with me the fruit of spiritual desire for man's freedom and forgiveness of self and of others in the world of form. For the energies men have held in suspension as a result of hardness of their heart has to the present hour, to this blessed moment, kept the mankind of earth in a constant state of degradation. For each time that there is an action of unforgivingness, there is a counteraction which produces in the world of form those unfortunate thoughts and feelings that do not permit life to come to a state of precious balance. Will you then join with me now in releasing your feelings of frustration, of fear, and of torment? Will you in the world order determine that you will contribute significantly toward the advancement of world harmony by freeing yourself through the power and ritual of universal forgiveness from every error and error thought you have ever created in any past time? For your momentum, precious ones, is always creating its record through the power of action and reaction in the bank of the spiritual records of God. There are some, it is true, who in a state of blissful ignorance trip lightly on their way and do not think that they themselves matter much in the divine scheme. Again and again, the archangels, the cosmic beings, and the ascended masters have conveyed to mankind, or attempted to do so, some full measure of awareness as to the individual's responsibility in the world. We stress then that you are the open door into octaves of light, that your consciousness is able to attune with the higher realms from which we come, and is able to act as a transformer of regeneration in the world order, that mankind may feel a renewal of their right passions toward the Godhead for the great gift of life. One of the most marvelous applications which we have is called the ritual of gratitude. When among the seven archangels we stand and face the holy east of regenerate beginning, we stand there and emanate great waves of light, the light of our gratitude, back to our divine source for all the energy that has ever been entrusted to us down through the ages. I want you to know that each one of the archangels represents one note in a grand cosmic scale. And when we function by levers of infinite harmony, by harmonic patterns, there is created a music of gratitude back to God's heart, which enables the entire system of worlds in which we function to feel the pressure of our gratitude back to the Godhead. This is an experiment which those of you who have some knowledge of your affinity for certain rays can also use from day to day in your own individual service to life. Beloved ones, if you will only understand the infinite laws of harmony and the power of transmutation, you will draw forth then the gratitude flame from the heart of God for every gift that life has given to you. And as you do it, as the power of that action of gratitude cascades in mighty concentric waves of light back to the heart of the great central sun, you will find that the law of supply and demand is once again met. For as you give, so you shall receive. And when the heart of God is made aware of your gratitude, at that specific moment, the momentum of the universal is touched, and the response is a chord and a release of an infinite increment of harmony that starts out from the beginning and passes through all life expressions in time and space down to the present moment right where you are, and brings into that moment the celestial realization of the universe's gratitude for your love and gratitude. This is divine response. This is the cognition of you by the deity, a renewal of your mind that enables the world to be blessed by God's love flow through you. Won't you accept that now in your feeling world? Won't you accept the pressure of that sense of God's gratitude for your own? If you will do this, it will enable me to perform specific acts and functions for and on behalf of the family of nations. For today, as you have been apprised in this conference, and as you have known prior to coming here, there are many cesspools of recalcitrant energies in the world community that cry out for redemption and change. The need for change is apparent in the world order. The hungers of men for change, their thirst for reality, causes the angelic and cosmic host to seek new avenues of spiritual blessing, assisting men to develop and unfold the reality of themselves in the world of form. Now we want you to know that there are various moments when the Immaculate Host will temper their energies to the shorn lamb of man's identity. This is not governed by mortal law, but by immortal law. This is not governed by human reason, and no individual upon the planet has the power to opaque our light. For we are able to step it up when we lower our voice, or decrease it when we raise it. And we can do it vice versa. It is not necessary, it is quite true, that at all times we should speak in full volume and momentum. But I say to you all, dear hearts, including those specific ones who crave our inward knowledge and apprehension, that there are laws governing our release of energy that you know not of, that are most glorious when understood, that enable us to do for the world more by crying with a loud voice than when we speak softly, or when we speak with great volume and power. It enables the shard composed of man's mortal substance that surrounds the individual psyche to be shattered. Now the shattering of that shard by divine light is not an undesirable experience. When this is done by human momentums of hatred, of resentment, of wrongly qualified energy, and that energy leaks into the aura of an individual, it has a tendency to upset and disturb the world of the individual. But once individuals can overcome their resentment of unusual volumes of energy and torrents of our power, once they can adjust themselves to the higher vibratory action and understand the law of the electrode, which makes each individual in the room who will accept it a vibrating reed in the universal organ of cosmic harmony. They will see that by maintaining the pressure of harmony and feelings in their worlds, they are able to assist us in our gigantic release of assistance to millions upon the planet and to souls waiting at the portals of birth and death, especially those at the portals of birth, to come in with a lesser degree of karma than would otherwise be possible. For every activity of the archangels is a specific activity. It is the flow and release of torrents of universal harmony into the world order. Because of the petulancy of generations, because of human selfishness and a craving for expression that is not universal, men and women have become crystallized in concepts of pain and despair. This is not the will of heaven. And in this age of great peril, when the year itself has cycled through awful happenings and disturbing conditions, and when the hearts of men are failing them for fear of what is coming upon the earth, we desire to create new visions in the consciousness of the students of the ancient words. Behold, I make all things new. Behold, I create a new heaven and a new earth, and the former things shall be passed away. For surely this generation and its lack of perception and fortitude shall pass away, with its opportunities lost forever. But individuals who have received the precious seed, to whom is entrusted the precious secret, will cognize that the doorway of a new age will once again raise men into the realization of the divine cornucopia, that they will understand that the mystery of the divine is a continuing one, and the gap between the positive and negative pole is filled by the spiritual power and energy of the Godhead flashing forth through myriad individuals on higher planes dedicated to the release of cosmic Christ truth. You here below, many of you, are children of destiny. Children of destiny to whom was entrusted a specific aspect of the white stone. Children of destiny to whom was entrusted a specific functional action in the world of form as well as in the realm of the invisible. To you has been given the jewels and scepter of authority for mankind to accept, not only for presently embodied mankind, the fiats of Almighty God, but to also accept for the ages the continuation of the pulsation of the divine flame, and the realization that the power and energy and love, the mounting dynamism of the mysteries of heaven in the world community, must expand and cannot accept the awful crystallization of this age which has sought to imprison it as in a cage of glass. Men then passing by see this flame flower of the divine majesty not as a thing of action, but as a frozen, qualitative activity, bereft of its quantitative action. For if the power of the universal, limitless light were to be imprisoned, the universe would stop. Activity should cease. And thus, albeit men have amassed and used have garnered and imprisoned vast quantities of the universal supply of energy into the world order and have kept it in prison by the substance of gross carnal thoughts, there still remains a universal abundance which is held in abeyance as cosmic gifts and graces for mankind at higher levels. And oh, how we yearn to impart this to men. But the lords of karma in their deliberations from time to time have stressed to us in the midst of our zeal to carefully observe the law, lest we bestow upon an age already bent toward destruction so much excess energy that it would tip in the balance scales the whole structure of the age and destroy it as it toppled in upon itself. And therefore the restraining hand of the lords of karma and the wisdom of the divine has cut off at many moments in the history of man their supply of energy as a deliberate action of the universal mind, calculated to restrain the heavy hand of careless men lest they upset the apple carts of the world and bring toppling the heads of men in revolt, rebellion, and disturbing outer conditions which would not provide the avenues of order which man ought to seek and extol as valuable episodes of opportunity to the children of men to live and to learn those wholesome aspects which have always enabled the fabric of society to weave the Christ threads of spiritual illumination into their outer garments. We want you then to understand that the power of transmutation is also intelligent. Some individuals say, if we sin again and again, can we be forgiven? The law of the 7 times 70, so beautifully stated by the Christ, assures mankind of a continual round of infinite forgiveness. But the law of the second death, which regardless of outer human agencies or purported statements from higher levels, has not ceased to exist, continues to assure mankind that if they persist in a downward course, the burning of the candle at both ends and in the middle, they can destroy themselves or become castaways from the Father's many mansions. This is not the will of God. This is not the intent of God. But it is the mercy of the great law that after individuals have rejected again and again the opportunities and life experiences which have been given them, they are then recalled and separated from the outer personality, the substance of that personality and memory, cause effect, being cast into the infinite light known of old upon Atlantis as the Maxim light. The power of the light of the law, the infinite power of cosmos that stands at the dividing of the way between light and darkness, between the positive and the negative, the combination of those energies strips then the personality of man from the soul substance, from the spirit of man. And he is returned as a young and fresh ego back to the heart of the Father to once again come forth in renewed sisophric rounds and to be given experiences so that he may once again begin the journey back to God's heart through the process of restoration. But the second death involves the personality, the cause, the effect, the record, and the memory. The good and the bad, then, if there be any good of that life stream, is all returned to the universal. This does not happen too frequently, and none of you need concern yourself with it. But it is a factor that should alert all men to understand that continual forgiveness is not the intention of the Creator. Forgiveness being a clearing of the record, that by the power of transmutation, men might rise in the cosmic scheme. This engenders hope in every heart and is the power of the universal Christ to mediate the destiny of men, to bring them to a higher order. It should show each one of you that each person can renew themselves in hope, in faith, and in cosmic charity, and as they do so, reestablish their relationship with the infinite and with the realm of the archangels. We come to assist you in your transmutation this day. We come to assist you mightily. Members of my band, Zadkiel calls. Zadkiel calls. Zadkiel calls. Descend and raise the vibratory action of the individuals who are here to a realization of the power of holy amethyst. Raise your consciousness. Raise the consciousness of mankind. Create now the sacred fire jewel around the atmosphere of this room. Transmutation rays blaze forth, creating a giant cauldron of violet flame substance. Elohim, Elohim, Elohim of transmutation, act. Bestow now the power of universal forgiveness upon the sons of men. Let the priests of the sacred order of Zadkiel descend, those invisible yet tangible beings dedicated to the freedom of man from the records of sin, of death, of shadow, of shame, of misuse of energy. Examining the scrolls of each one's records, let us now then apply for each one as they join with me in application to the heart of the karmic lords for extensions and acts of mercy on behalf of these thy children, that the tenure of their days upon this planet should be increased according to their noble aspirations to serve. Those who would serve, let them then be extended according to the karmic plan which was worked out by the spiritual mathematicians before I descended. And let the gifts and graces we desire to impart become a tangible part of each individual's consciousness at inward levels. It is done. It is done. It is done. It has been spoken, and it is finished. Noble is thy work, O God, and most noble thy activity of forgiveness. From the beginning, O Lord, thou didst seek to glorify and amplify the passion of perfection in every soul. Thou didst give to each one thy great fire rings. Thou didst give to each one thy sacred flame. Thou didst give to each one the spirit spark in its natural reality, and its power to enter into the heart of every part of space and hallow it, of every part of the stream of time, and consume the dross and release the flow of the golden hours of perfection into manifestation, forward and backward, out of the nexus of the present hour. Then thou didst speak, and behold, thou didst see the need to glorify thy creation with that foreknowledge which thou hast created from the beginning. And behold, the conveyance of that knowledge into the present moment is the desire to see each one enter the gateway of the eternal now and find that the past and the present and the future are welded into one concentric whole, one vast diorama of spiritual beauty and purity. Remove human fretwork. Remove the vestiges and traces of mortal worry and the propensity to worry. Replace it by active concern for individual and collective destiny. Remove excess concentration upon the individual expression of the ego and replace it by a divine perception of each individual's niche in the universal scheme. Remove from the consciousness of man a sense of separation and integrate each soul through the power of the mighty God presence into his personal, intimate contact with his God presence. The law of love is fulfilled. The law of transmutation is acting. And now withdraw the sacred fire jewel, for I would convey to each one a specific bit of knowledge. The lords of karma have granted each individual that hears my words and hears this dictation shall receive the impartation of the radiance of beloved holy amethyst and myself in cosmic service to this planet to pass through the flame of your heart for a period of 1 hour while you are sleeping for the next 24 days. This flame of transmutation to assist you in understanding and building a momentum, a hunger momentum for purification and for the expression of the natural powers of the Godhead. I see now as through a veil, the veil of your human creation, that many of you have established momentums and generated them of limitation for yourselves. You have actually looked up to other individuals for the actual qualitative and quantitative release of universal power toward perfection that ought to have manifested in your own world. We speak not to condemn you, but to reassure you that this need not be a continuing factor in your evolution. From this hour, if you will accept it, I am giving and I am conveying a mighty tidal release of infinite power, the power of forgiveness toward every part of life that will help you on the instant to forgive individuals that formerly you have found it difficult to forgive. And to forgive yourselves and to accept the infinite forgiveness of God for yourselves and for mankind in generating a period of mercy in the tides of life manifest release so that individuals and planets in this system of worlds can be the beneficiaries of the thoughts of heaven and that intruding mercy of heaven which comes now in this age of deceit and trouble as a gift of God, a precious dripping of the divine ointment upon the stone of man's recalcination. I want you to know then that there are thousands of individuals in this city that are hungry for the word that we release, that hunger for the vibratory action of freedom which we release into this room upon the focal plane of your identities. Yet because of religious bigotry, because of religious tolerations and intolerations, they would not expose themselves to us and our release of spiritual energy, for they know not what they do. Yet they hunger, they thirst, they call for action, they call for revelation, and they remain in the stultified, stratified levels of human density in which they have long been imprisoned. I say, let us pray for them, and let us say that this hour we can effect a release in this city that should and ought to dislodge some of them from their lairs, that this afternoon and evening they may recognize the need to stream into this temple, which has actually withdrawn to a place 200 feet above the building and remains here throughout this conference to cap the conference with a crown of the mercy of the violet transmuting flame as the energy of transmutation released from God's heart for his mercy's sake to all the children of men. For we are concerned with the struggle for freedom that goes on in the world domain, in Czechoslovakia, in Poland, in Russia herself, behind the bamboo curtain in China, and behind the iron curtain everywhere, and upon Cuba, that lovely island over which my temple is focused. Oh, how we long to see the people of that island once again released from their feelings of antagonism toward the people of the United States, that they would send forth the energies of regeneration until that island would, through the natural patterns of life, once again enter into a state of verdure, the beauty of the foliage of the land being also reflected in the thoughts of the people as the sense of divine abundance would release into the world cornucopia, a spirit of loving cooperation which naturally emanates from our temple of transmutation. Won't you accept then in God's name those gifts which I have given you this day? Won't you accept in God's name a passion for freedom, a love for freedom from the stain of discord and oppression self-imposed and imposed upon you by the thoughts of others who have limited you one and all in various means and have denied you that freedom of expression which God's law, functional within yourself, would express unto all life as the abundant life. In the name of heaven, in the name of Saint Germain, in the name of the great divine director, in the name of every friend who has ever embraced the banner of freedom down through the ages, I say, let us determine that we shall succeed where others have failed. Let us determine that this age shall accept the fruit of the endeavors of heaven on behalf of the mankind of earth. You are enough here even this morning, if you will accept the pressure of that in your feeling worlds, to turn the tide in human affairs, to create a greater hunger in the hearts of mankind and a direction toward the forces of light that can and will produce significant changes in the world order. If you will accept that now, then, for and on behalf of mankind, we will extend our gifts according to the measured limitations of the karmic lords out into the world of form to assist all in receiving some measure of moratorium in their world. We say then to the angels of our band, go forth to the prison houses of the world, where men are incarcerated for various crimes, and touch them with the coals from the altar we have established here. Let them feel that the forces of freedom are once again on the march, and that hope for the future includes them wherever they are. Let us also go to the hospitals, to the old folks' homes, to the places where individuals have a spirit of human lethargy and hopelessness. And let us regenerate within them and charge within them our energy of universal love, restating then their cosmic purpose and whispering it into the ears of their holy Christ self, so that as a surge of our energy levels goes into the dimensions of their thought and feeling world, it will act to stimulate not only in those individuals here, but throughout the world order, a new sense and feeling of freedom, a passion for happiness, a resurge of happiness, a feeling of divine buoyancy and joy as the configurations of immortality unite with man's expressions of mortality in their imperfect forms and seek to stir within them the perfect memory that God has placed there from the beginning. I thank you in the name of the spiritual hierarchy, and I make my face to shine upon you as the sun. Sign of the heart and the hand to you. May the memory of God's love bestowed upon us by Archangel Zadkiel linger with us always. Pax vobiscum. Stillness of your consciousness, we create reverence for the immortal spark, the regenerative power that is within ye all. We summon from the four corners of the earth the devotees of the Sacred Heart of God, who understand the need to breathe the air of the Holy Spirit and the truth that the Holy Spirit brings into manifestation. Fear and doubt and the troubles of humankind are themselves barriers to divine realization. But the light of the reality of God within your hearts is able to shatter the illusions of self and to proclaim to mankind everywhere that the strength of the earth is in the soul of men who understand the need to awaken the senses of the soul and the perceptions thereof, that they may once again drink of the waters of immortal life. Think ye that it is the desire of any ascended being to see mankind wallow in the ignorance of deceit, to continue to be self-deceived, to hold themselves in a conception of imperfection, when the regenerative powers of universal love from the farthest reaches of space are magnificently conveying to the earth those crested jewels of immortal perfection that will enable each soul to summon that faith for himself that will shatter his sense of limitation and enable him to do the things which I have done and the things which ye can do, and to imbue men with faith once again. At a time in the history of creation when the world is continually pained by outer manifestation and the fact that they have vacated from their consciousness the sublime sense of universal reality relating the identity to the Father. It has been said that I spake long ago, saying, I and my Father are one, and the unity of the Father with the Son is today a necessary ingredient in the initiatic perfection which the spiritual seeker must call forth and evoke from on high if he is to manifest the power to shatter the bonds of illusion and to feel that he is once again victor over sense, consciousness, and mortality. For the flow of mortality is a flow of illusion from one type of confusing manifestation to another. But the flow of reality is the power of light which comes into mankind not only through the heart but through the eye of the spirit, known of old to the ancients as the spiritual eye in the center of the forehead, the door of ingress where spiritual power does flow and create the star fire of manifestation that reveals the magnificent of the threefold flame pattern, the pink of divine love, the blue of the holy will, and the glow of the golden flame of illumination. Christ in perfection in these three primary color ingredients is that which enables individuals to create the seamless garment of light around about themselves and the power to cast out the entities of imperfection that constantly are whispering into the ears of mankind those stultifying words which make men to shrivel, and the seed of reality within dries up and there is no vibrant vitality manifesting in their being. While heaven calls forth amongst mankind, saying, we summon you now to the feast of identity, where you are able to recognize that man's need is not to eat the flesh of captains and of kings and of wise men, but to devour instead the Christed power of the sacred Eucharist, to identify with the body of God, to identify with the reality of God, to sustain oneself by cognition, directly from the heart of your own divine God presence, the mighty sense of the I am then, as the regenerative sense of every man, recreates those passions of identity which were the beginning of consciousness in the race. When men first perceived in the dim fashionings of conveyance of individuality the radiant purposes behind individuality, and they saw that because God was, they were, holding their existence to be in the supremacy of identification with the primacy of radiant order, the law of the one. Hear then, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one. That which is real, that which is earnest, that which is sincere, that which holds the power of freedom within itself is that primal substance from which all things outward as well as inward were made. The law of the Logos is the law of the Word. It is the emanation of the deity from the heart origin of the beginning that radiates in cycles out into the world. Worlds without end, showing men the way back to the divine heart. But individuals have sought refuge in false identities, and the masquerades have gone on. But I spake of old, saying, think ye that those upon whom the Tower of Siloam fell were sinners above all those that dwelt in Jerusalem? I tell you, nay, for except ye repent, ye shall likewise perish. And the meaning of the repentance is to turn from the discordant manifestations of the mortal sense with its evaporating power, to hold man to a cohesive reality. And the sundering of the cord of universal harmony and identification with the God presence. For men see themselves as the little finite child without hope in the world, standing upon the stairs of cycles, ever new beginnings, and failing to apprehend in the whole round of the cycle the law of love that would have enabled them to know and to enjoy their freedom to infinitely express that cosmic Christ truth that would cause them to wear the white robe of universal perfection. The order of heaven has not paled. The order of heaven has not failed. The order of heaven has not seceded. The order of heaven has succeeded. And when we say unto you at this moment that you live in a time of great peril, when the princes of darkness have come into the world order and have sought through the flesh of kings, of captains, and of mighty men to captivate the youth of the world, to see the temporal crown, it is again the whisperings of the Luciferian horde saying, if you will fall down and worship me, I will give you all the things of this world. And I say with all of Christ's truth to ye all that these promises are not kept. These promises fail to materialize, for it is like unto a Faustinian pact. The soul then sold into the toils of treachery cannot reap the fruit of spiritual sincerity. And mankind go then as beggars to the court of God, and they ask for a sou, when all that is necessary is the recognition of the real you. God has made you in his own image. The trembling of that image is the beautiful reality which will enable you to shatter the illusions of this moment or any other moment. For in the moment of failure, if men will only recognize that we do not intend them to eat the husks, but to partake of the feast of light that is brought about by a sense of the survival of the universal deity. For when men think that they themselves in one moment may cease to be, they have a tendency to feel that God is like unto themselves, made in the human image. It is not so. It is not so, and we have lifted up our voice upon thousands of hills in the world, proclaiming that Christ truth that beams hope and freedom in ever new crescendos of infinite passion for the soul into the world order, and summons mankind to the realization of his own immortal wholeness. Will you then with me now envision around yourself my seamless garment? For a replica of myself now comes to stand by the side of every devotee of Christ's truth and say, I would invest you with this garment of swaddling pure light until the immortal seed, flame, spark, infinite reality of self parts the veil of illusion and enables the flesh form to transcend itself, to be reborn as the mind is renewed by the spirit of infinity, calling forth and summoning from the great celestial towers of reality that heavenly wisdom which has been bestowed throughout the ages upon the elect, which to this hour is imminent in the atmosphere of the planet and awaits the calling forth by every individual of its joy, of its release, of its flame, of its peace, of its strength, of the name of God I am, of the I am law, the resurrecting power that enables each one of you for yourselves at any moment of outer distress to call unto the divine presence and say, lo, I am come. This is not the outer self in action then. It is the power of infinity speaking in the finite world. I am come. Will you get that sense into your consciousness, blessed ones? Lo, I am come. As Saint Germain said to you long ago, I am here and I am there. If you will but have that sense, it will enable you to overcome those weaknesses in the picturization of your perfection that has allowed you to be indulgent with yourselves and to say, this is my image, as others hold for you a destructive and deleterious form, a concept of perfidy, of shadow, of shame, of mortality, of illusion, and of a waning flame that sheds hopelessness into the world community. Whereas I am hope, I am faith, I am charity reborn, is the power to light again the taper of individuality and enable you one and all to raise your torch of Christ's victory in the world order that will create that holiness of concept, that purity of thought that dwelled amongst us in days of old. For the elect are the great white brotherhood. They are those who have chosen to wash their robes white in the infinite light of God, who have understood that from the first photon flash of cosmic light reality glimmering in the domain of consciousness, there was every whit the intention of God in the divine heart to enable each individual to overcome those hurdles of personal dimension and to feel the full divine intention surging, flowing through the individual consciousness, bringing into view the summoning of cosmic election and resurgent hope, perfection manifest as law, infinite love, compassion from above, sweeping through the world order and sustaining for all a new burst of freedom as immortal life. I am the resurrection flame. I am the resurrection and the life of every cell, of every organ, of every part of manifestation. I endow, I imbue, I enlighten consciousness. Did I not say, come unto me, all ye who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest? Did I not say, my burden is light? Well then, what are you waiting for? My burden was light in Judea of old. My burden is light in America today and in the world order. My burden is the sustainment of light in the world community. And I am the Nazarene carpenter who seeks to frame in the world order those sustaining elements of cosmic Christ love that teach man how to be a good neighbor unto all that he meets, to evoke responses in the hearts of the men and women on the streets, to go out into the highways and byways and compel men to lay hold upon immortal life and to seize those elements that say the strife is o'er. The struggle is ended, for the swaddling garments which I wear are the seamless garments of universal love, which ye all are endowed with, which ye all were endowed with, which is God's portion to every man, every prodigal son of you, calling you forth now then in the world community and in the world order to once again let the being of the elect flash forth the glimmer of the internal light in the world order, the outward expression coming then more and more into view as the immaculate sense to bestow upon everyone the wholeness pattern that makes men free, the holiness pattern that makes men to see the law of love that I am is the law of love that ye are. There is no difference in us but one of attainment. It is a matter of levels of attainment. Ye stand now at the portal of that attainment. Ye stand at the threshold of cycle stair of the personal individual world of you. And we who support in the world domain the fashions of freedom do create new garments of loveliness for you to wear, that you may wear them proudly before men to bring emancipation into the universal order of men, to bring communion once again with the angelic host and with the hosts of light is our prayer. Ye seek healing of body, no healing of soul. Ye seek healing within your feeling world, no healing that produces the end of stain and sense of blame. No healing that enables you to see that which is real, to see it, to handle it, to touch it, to be molded by the word, the fashion of adoration, Adonai. Adonai. O our Father, these are thy children, called of old to their hidden destiny, and all men are thy children, flames, sparks, and spirits of the One. Mold them now and shape them by the sun of their personal destiny. Let the flame within them begin once again its round to the pinnacle of achievement. Summon in them the best gifts and let them go free. For the hour is now when they that are in the grave shall hear my voice, and those whited sepulchres moving yet among men shall find that the dead men's bones of human lore, which they have held in consciousness, nevermore have given them their freedom, and they will replace it now by the word of God, thyself. Thou art within them. I am the power to set you free. I thank you.
But the foe and the word go forth lovingly. In the flame, glowing flame, in the harmony flame, in the light, radiant light, in God harmony light, in the stillness of God, in the quivering flame, angel wings all abide with thee, blessed God of harmony. In the light, starry light, cosmic light unending, I would be in the sea of thy holy bliss expanding. In the light, virgin light, in the womb of cosmos, I'll abide in thee, blessed God, harmony.
Universal love, we pour forth those inward tones which summon the elect to awareness that God is within the temple of your being. The power of this light and the energy of transmutation form before the gaze a concept of a violet flame sea. The violet flame sea is one in which all may be baptized into, to feel the pulsations of transmutation's law, and to understand that that law is the mercy of God, based upon his mercy, based upon the full trembling of the hand of the divine in the cup of manifestation. I am come that I might create in your thoughts understanding about harmony, understanding about that harmony which is the specific quality of life within your own heart flame. You do not know, you cannot imagine in the outer just what it will do for you when you will decree inwardly to keep the harmony regardless of what outer conditions you may be facing. For outer conditions are continual recreations of individual karma and also deliberate attacks against the children of the light. For whensoever one takes a stand for the light, whenever an individual determines that they will become a part of the Godhead, of the hierarchy, of the spiritual order, and they take their stand in the world of form, let them remember and understand that this is not just an outer action. It is not a mere vow spoken by the lips, but it is also an activity of record whereby their energy enters into the place beyond the veil and is recorded directly upon the manifestation of universal Akasha. There the deity manifests the fullness of the law of love and the law of universal harmony. And individuals will find that the charge of that harmony is retained by their outer selves in many cases, not only for one embodiment, but passing through many embodiments until one charge of that universal harmony can sustain them through the ages. But precious ones, some individuals are very short-sighted. They gaze upon a particular momentum that they have in their worlds of negativity. And when that negativity comes into manifestation, they are prone to forget all of the magnificent outpourings of the light and of harmony that they have experienced throughout their domain, their tenure upon this terrestrial ball. As I come to you tonight, it is in the full awareness of the needs of the hour. It is in the full awareness of the universal power, the universal panacea of harmony as an unguent of the Brotherhood that causes hearts to meld, to flow into one another, and to identify with the universal order of the angelic host. You wondered about that burst, that release from our heart. It is in order to shatter the matrices of limiting consciousness that enfold many individuals, even as a mirror that does not portray truth, but portrays idolatry. This is the idolatry of the outer self in its outer manifestation. It has fixed its limitations upon men. It has caused them to feel a yearning for reality, however, because the contrast media of outer self manifestation compared to the universal preeminence of the divine self creates a yearning. And so, while we do not say, let us do evil that good may come, we recognize that when the dark forces try their best, they are also creating before your gaze some idea of the awful conditions of temporal existence and individual outer world manifestation. This then creates a yearning in the heart for freedom, for deliverance, for relief, for universal harmony, for peace. Of course, you have heard it before, and it is not new, that individuals sometimes beat their head against the wall because it feels so good when they stop. But precious ones, there is more truth and more poetry to this statement than men would care sometimes to admit. For I think it is safe to say that men are their own worst enemies. And from time to time, they will continue to recreate in a masochistic manner the very same negative patterns over and over again, and then lament the fact that they exist. We call to you now in God's name to forsake the tendency to inharmony. If you will only fix in your consciousness that it is impossible for your divine presence to be inharmonious ever, if you will only fix in your outer consciousness that your divine consciousness has never, in all eternity, never partaken of any condition that is less than harmonious, this should itself serve as a universal magnet and a principle of universal order whereby you can fashion for yourself determined efforts toward the future. This is progress. It does not matter, beloved ones, that you have erred in the past, What is important is that you are able to overthrow the tendency to error, to recognize that tomorrow can be better than today, that the past is prologue, that there is hope even in the midst of unfortunate outer conditions. Hope can exist side by side with frustration, but when individuals will let go and let their own God presence work and serve through them, they will find a quick end to the frustrating sense that follows man's tendency to always be concerned with the outer self. What do they think of me? Will they like me? Will they think my hair is nice? Will they think that I am attired properly? Will they consider my conduct to be honorable, that I am well-mannered? What will they think of me? Well, precious ones, the important question of the moment is, what does your divine presence think of you? What do the masters of wisdom think of your actions and of the hidden aspirations of your heart? This is the most important thing for you to be concerned with, for when you are concerned with that, outer conditions have a tendency to vanish away. The vanishing point then, the point of nihilism to human aspirations, is man's reaching up to the heart of his presence. When he understands the power and energy that exists in the presence, when he understands the universal harmony that exists in the presence, when he understands the buoyancy, the freedom from fear, the magnificent power and energy that he can pour through his flesh form, in the overcoming of ideas even that have for many years made tired old men and women out of those who could otherwise lift up their heads and laugh with the stars. Oh, you have not thought of that? Precious ones, the morning stars sang together for joy is not merely a statement of poetic license. It happens to be an idea of the universal order of the holy spheres of God that are inhabited by magnificent cosmic beings that most of you have not imagined. No, not in your wildest imaginings. For these lofty beings, with their pipes and their strings, with their harmonies and their beautiful facets, are beyond the concept of poet, artist, and musician. They are the universal order of the harmony of worlds, the harmony of spheres. And when men are able to penetrate through the light years of reality and the realization of reality, and to hear the messages of the holy spheres, the morning stars singing together for the glory of cosmic purpose, there is born in the united heart, in the heart that is united to harmony, an awareness and a passion for life, for living, for reality that can never be taken away. I then bestow upon you tonight a full measure, as the cosmic law will permit, of my own mounted momentum of comprehension and joy concerning the universal spheres of love and light and illumination. I ask that this place shall be charged with the glory of the eternal presence, the universal order of that great musician known as Muses. Some of you perhaps did not know that there was a great being who still is and always shall be, known as Muses. That Muses actually did the same thing that Moses did for the children of Israel. That Muses drew out of the universal heart the thoughts of God and set them to order and universal harmony. You can tune in with the work of Muses. You can feel the joy and the harmony and the love that poured out with his thought and understand the significant contribution of the law of the one. Man then is not useless, as cosmic beings are not useless. Man is useful, as cosmic beings are useful, and each man, artist in his own right, creator in his own domain, may draw forth from the harmonies of God the power that will help the least majesty of the universe to speak through the open door of his own being. Harmony, harmony, harmony. Bestow upon these children of the sun the droppings of the mind of God, the holy burnings of the sacred flame order, the release of universal harmony as the spheres and the silent seeming stars now release their power into the thought processes of men. For it has been said that man's faults lie not with his stars, but with himself. And this is because he has not attuned with the universal harmony of universal spheres and with those universal intelligences that under divine guidance cause the diurnal movements of the various solar bodies in interstellar space. The turning of living worlds, the turning of living worlds, the turning of living worlds, and the beautiful spherical releases of harmonic light patterns, infinitely rising, pulsating and falling, crescendos and then the silent dying away as of the wind, the sobbing of the universal heart crying for creative expression in all the manifold patterns of nature, the ascended masters as they stand forth and raise up arms to the deity and invoke the lost word, the logos, the power of light, the fiats of right, the fiats of universal purity, not petulancy, but order, not vanity and disarray, but crystallic manifestation, the whitening of man, not as a sepulcher or a tomb, a place where man is not, but a place where man is. Lo, I am here, lo, I am there, did Saint Germain say to you long ago. And in those thoughts and lofty concepts, those worded ideas so childlike in sweet simplicity, was the order of the ages born, the concept of man not tethered to a thorn, but to a rose. The concept of man not filled with the idea of dimming light, but the light of infinity which glows. Not man going out into the dark, but man universal, which flows into the world as the givingness of his gettingness, as the reality that lieth not in repose, but in sincerity, reality, immensity, and comprehension of harmony that flows and flows and flows and flows and bypasses men who stoop to pick up grains of sand and trickle it through their fingers until those fingers become a bony structure of death. There is no life left, but only a decaying substance manifest in the wind. This is not reality. This is not harmony. But the harmony of God is the newness of life, the promise of life, the hope that pulses on the temple flame of the heart, the hope that saith, I am a part of the star of infinite reality. I glow with God, I go with God, I feel with him. I am because he is, lo, I am. This cannot die. This can only live. This reaches to the sky, for this can only give. Harmony, 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 pulsating harmony. Harmony, 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 pulsating harmony. Harmony, 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 giving to all this harmony. This is life, this is love, this is no discord, no jangle, but a soothing power for tired nerves, for tired energies. It is refreshment sphere, it is light delight, and it is the right and the might that maketh all things right. Harmony is the key. Won't you join me then in trying from this day forth, by all of the resolve that you have within your heart, to be harmonious in all of your dealings with all mankind, and determine that never again will you ever permit any outer condition to disturb that perfect equipoise of the divine light that blazes forth upon the altar of God within you. Won't you determine to give full expression to that beautiful flame, that flame that spins for you the Christed garment of yourself and the identity of immortality, which will not put you on a shelf, but will take you off the shelf that mortality has put you upon and give you your freedom? Have you thought about it? Harmony is the key. Have you thought about it? Harmony makes you free. Have you thought about it? Harmony is sincerity. Harmony, harmony for God's sake and for man's. Oh, I want to tell you, precious ones, I regret taking leave of you now. I would like to abide with you. I would like to live with you. I would like to share my feeling for the universe with you. But until individual shall learn how to follow that perfect law of universal harmony that is within themselves, I must go to those spheres in which I live and pray that you yourselves will learn to give such harmony to the world that I can come to you and you can come to me, and we can renew ourselves daily in that lave, that pool of infinite love that washes us by the washing of the water, by universal logistics.
On earth, each one is a flame. Each one shares the I Am name. Being, all-seeing, liberty, freeing, making the world beautiful, wonderful, the counselor. Service we live, through service we give, for Christ enfoldeth all men. Sign of the heart and the head, and the hand to you. May the peace of the presence abide with you, wherever you are, wherever you go. May the glorious peace from the presence flow through days of service and nights of rest. May the peace of the presence keep you blessed, the sign of the heart and the head, the hand to you. May Gautama's cosmic cross of white fire enfold you with the Christ radiance of the brethren in white as you do his will, now and forever.